Hello dear subscribers, hope you all are doing well. A warm welcome to our YouTube channel. Jacob Rasmussen was a 20-year-old massage therapist living in Naples, Florida. Originally from a small town in Minnesota, Jacob had moved to Naples seeking better opportunities and a warmer climate. He was known for his good looks, athletic build, and charming personality, which quickly made him popular among his clients, especially older women. Jacob had a knack for making people feel special, which helped him build a loyal client base. Jacob's charm and good looks also brought him into the world of sugar babies, where younger people enter into sexual relationships with older, wealthier individuals in exchange for gifts and financial support. Jacob had several sugar mommies, but his primary one was Veronica Hayas, a 59-year-old astrologist. While Jacob enjoyed the benefits of these relationships, they also inevitably brought complications and tensions. In the days leading up to his death, Jacob was excited about his future. He had recently received a generous gift from one of his clients, an AI SUV, which he proudly showed off to his friends. He was also planning a trip to Disney World with some of his friends, something he had been looking forward for months. Jacob's Instagram was filled with posts about his plans, from pictures of his new car to countdowns to his Disney trip. Despite these complexities, Jacob remained optimistic and full of life. He was known for his infectious smile and positive attitude. Friends and clients alike admired his ambition and drive. Jacob's life, filled with dreams and plans, would be cut short in a tragic and shocking way. On the morning of August 12, 2016, Jacob Rasmussen's neighbor, Linda Martino, started her day like any other. Linda was a 95-year-old retired school teacher from Brooklyn who lived next door to Jacob in the Naples, Florida apartment complex. She often chatted with Jacob and had become concerned when she noticed his car, a shiny new Audi SUV, hadn't moved in 2 weeks. Linda thought it was odd because Jacob usually had a busy schedule. Around 9 a.m., Linda decided to check on Jacob. She knocked on his door but got no answer. Worried, she used the spare key Jacob had given her for emergencies. As soon as she opened the door, she felt something was wrong. The apartment was too quiet and a faint, unpleasant smell filled the air. Linda called out Jacob's name, but there was no response. She walked to the living room and into the hallway. When she reached the bathroom, she saw a horrifying sight. Jacob was lying face down in the toilet naked. His head was submerged in the water and his body was limp. Linda screamed and backed away, her heart racing, shaking. Linda ran back to her apartment and called 911, her voice trembling as she explained what she had found. "I think my neighbor is dead," she told the operator. "He is in his bathroom and it looks like something happened to him." The 911 operator stayed on the line with Linda, trying to keep her calm until the police arrived. Linda was in shock, pacing back and forth in her apartment and glancing nervously at Jacob's door. She couldn't believe what she had seen. Just a few days ago, Jacob had been full of life, talking about his plans to visit Disney World and showing off his new car. Within minutes, the Naples Police Department arrived at the scene. Officers secured the area and began their investigation. Linda was asked to wait outside while the police did their work. She sat on a bench, shaking and holding her head in her hands, trying to process the tragic event. News of Jacob's death quickly spread through the apartment complex. Neighbors gathered outside, whispering and speculating about what had happened. The local news soon picked up the story, with reporters arriving to cover the shocking discovery. Cameras captured the scene, showing the police presence and the concerned faces of the residents. Jacob's sudden and violent death left everyone in shock, especially those who knew him well. He was young, full of potential, and had a bright future ahead. Now his life was tragically cut short and his friends and family were left to mourn the loss. The Naples Police Department arrived quickly at the scene after Linda Martino's 911 call on August 12, 2016. Detective Samuel Jenkins led the investigation. He was known for his attention to detail and had solved many high-profile cases. His partner, Officer Karen Blake, was known for her sharp intuition and calm demeanor. As they entered Jacob Remusen's apartment, the officers immediately noticed the eerie silence. The living room was tidy with no signs of a struggle. A flat-screen TV was on the wall, and a few magazines, including the latest issue of GQ, were on the coffee table. The apartment looked normal, but the unsettling smell hinted at something more sinister. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake moved cautiously towards the bathroom where Jacob's body was found. The bathroom was small with white tiles and a modern shower. Jacob's naked body was slumped over the toilet, his head submerged in the water. There were no visible signs of a break-in and nothing seemed out of place, but the scene was disturbing. Jacob had been drowned, his head had been forced into the toilet, and there were bruises on his arms and neck, indicating a struggle. Detective Jenkins noted the position of the body and the bruising pattern, suggesting that Jacob had fought back against his attacker. The bathroom itself was clean, with no blood or other obvious evidence. The police began their methodical investigation. They took photographs of the entire apartment, collected fingerprints, and searched for any possible clues. They found a set of kitchen knives, but none appeared to be missing. Officer Blake found Jacob's phone on the kitchen counter. It was a new model, an iPhone 6S, and it might hold valuable information. She carefully bagged it for further analysis. Detective Jenkins and his team interviewed neighbors, including Linda Martino, to gather more information about Jacob's recent activities and any potential visitors. Linda mentioned seeing a few Jacob's clients come and go, but nothing seemed unusual. She also noted the new Audi SUV Jacob had recently received. The forensic team arrived and began their examination of the body and the apartment. They used luminol to check for traces of blood, even in areas that appeared clean. They also checked for hair fibers and other small pieces of evidence that might have been left behind by the attacker. As the investigation progressed, the police began to piece together a timeline of Jacob's last hours. They hoped that his phone and the security cameras in the apartment complex might provide additional clues. The clean state of the apartment and the lack of obvious evidence suggested that the killer had taken great care to cover their tracks. The tragic scene at Jacob's apartment marked the beginning of a complex investigation. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake knew they had a difficult case ahead of them. They were determined to find out who was responsible for the young man's untimely death and bring them to justice. The first suspect in the investigation was Veronica Hayas, a 59-year-old astrologist. Veronica was well known in Naples for her larger-than-life personality and her impressive client list, which included several celebrities. She lived in a lavish mansion decorated with exotic crystals and zodiac signs. Veronica had a reputation for being generous, often gifting expensive items to her friends and clients. However, she was also known to be possessive and obsessive, especially in her personal relationships. It was no contract that Veronica had been in a sexual relationship with Jacob Rasmussen, acting as a sugar mommy. She showered him with gifts, including the 70-inch flat-screen TV found in his house. When the police first questioned Veronica, she was calm but visibly upset. She admitted to being deeply hurt when she discovered that Jacob had been seeing other women. Despite her feelings, she denied any involvement in his death. Detective Samuel Jenkins and Officer Karen Blake conducted the interrogation. They were careful and thorough, asking Veronica about her whereabouts on the night of the murder. Veronica claimed that, like a typical Virgo, she was at home alone, reading the latest issue of Astrology Today and meditating. She insisted she had not seen Jacob for several days before his death and respected his need for privacy as a Scorpio. The police dug deeper into Veronica's background.
They found that she had a history of intense relationships, including 3 failed marriages that often ended badly, something she really admitted to, saying she couldn't help it due to someone with their moon in Cancer. Former friends and clients described her as charming but controlling. Several mentioned that Veronica's Cancer moon could make her very jealous, especially when she feel betrayed. This gave the police a possible motive for her to harm Jacob. During the interrogation, Veronica's demeanor shifted. She became more defensive and agitated, particularly when asked about her relationship with Jacob. She accused the police of unfairly targeting her because of her wealth, high-profile lifestyle, and belief in astrology. Despite her protest, the police continued to press her for details. The police also examined Veronica's phone records. They found multiple calls and text messages to Jacob in the days leading up to his death. Some of the messages were affectionate, while others were increasingly vicious, desperate, and accusatory. This evidence painted a picture of a relationship that was unraveling, with Veronica struggling to maintain control. Despite the mounting evidence and Veronica's increasingly erratic behavior, there was no direct proof linking her to the crime scene. The police needed more concrete evidence to make an arrest. As the investigation continued, Veronica remained a key suspect, her actions and history keeping her under close scrutiny. The second suspect the police investigated was Brian Mitchell, a 68-year-old Australian millionaire with quite the shocking backstory. Brian had recently moved to Naples after facing legal trouble in Australia, after a newspaper published allegations showing Brian allegedly trafficking asylum seekers to work in a restaurant chain for subhuman wages. Known for her outgoing and vivacious personality, Brian was also fiercely protective of her friends and had a temper that could flare up unexpectedly. Brian had started a sexual relationship with Jacob Rasmussen shortly before his death as another of his sugar mummies. She was generous, giving him expensive gifts, including the Audi SUV he received just before he died. When the police questioned Brian, she was cooperative but guarded. She acknowledged her relationship with Jacob and expressed shock at his death. Detective Samuel Jenkins and Officer Karen Blake led the interrogation. They asked Brian about her activities on the night Jacob was killed. Brian stated she had been at a naked masquerade ball at Naples Grand Beach Resort, mingling with other wealthy attendees and enjoying the evening. She provided the names of several people who could confirm her alibi, including local business owners and socialites. During the interrogation, Brian remained composed, but her demeanor shifted when asked about Jacob's other relationships. She seemed irritated and defensive, insisting she had no idea about his involvement with other women. The police found her reaction suspicious, as it hinted at possibly jealousy and a motive for harming Jacob. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake searched Brian's home for any evidence linking her to the crime. They found several expensive gifts she had planned to give Jacob, including a jet ski and an air hockey table and a PlayStation 4, indicating her deep investment in the relationship. In addition, they saw several large withdrawals from her bank account in the weeks leading up to Jacob's death. While this alone was not incriminating, it suggested she was heavily involved in Jacob's life and willing to spend significant amounts of money on him. They also discovered a series of text messages between Brian and Jacob. The messages started flirty but became more intense, with Brian expressing frustration over Jacob's lack of commitment. Despite Brian's cooperation and strong alibi, the police remained suspicious of her involvement. Her intense feelings for Jacob and possible jealousy provided a motive. But like Veronica, there was no direct evidence linking her to the murder. As the investigation continued, Brian's actions and connections to Jacob kept her under close watch by the authorities. The third suspect in the investigation was Marcus Dean, a 21-year-old who had been in a rivalry with Jacob. Marcus was known in Naples for being competitive and ambitious. He was also a sugar baby catering to wealthy married couples bored with their humdrum sex life. Marcus was driven to the best in his circle, always striving to outdo his peers in performance and number of sugar parents. His personality was described as hot-headed, and he had a history of getting into arguments and fights, often fueled by alcohol. The police questioned Marcus shortly after Jacob's body was found. Detective Samuel Jenkins and Officer Karen Blake led the interrogation, focusing on the nature of Marcus and Jacob's relationship. Marcus admitted that he and Jacob had been rivals, both vying for the attention and gifts of the same wealthy women. He described the relationship as tense, but insisted it was all a part of the competition. On the night of Jacob's death, Marcus claimed he was at a local bar, Patty Murphy's, with friends, celebrating a recent conquest with some wealthy couples. He provided the names of his friend who could confirm his alibi. However, Marcus' reputation for getting into fights after drinking raised suspicions about his possible involvement in Jacob's death. The police dug into Marcus' background, finding numerous reports of altercations with other sugar babies and clients. Many described Marcus as aggressive and quick to anger, especially when he felt threatened or disrespected. This temperament, combined with his rivalry with Jacob, gave the police a potential motive for murder. During the interrogation, Marcus initially remained calm but became defensive when asked about his whereabouts and relationship with Jacob. He denied any involvement in Jacob's death and accused the police of trying to pin the crime on him due to their rivalry. His agitation grew as the questioning continued, suggesting he was hiding something. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake searched Marcus' apartment for evidence. They found a few items linking him to Jacob, including a gold chain that Jacob had posted about on social media, saying it was a gift from a client. The police also discovered a series of text messages between Marcus and Jacob. The messages revealed escalating tensions, with Marcus accusing Jacob of stealing his clients and threatening to teach that bleep a bleeping lesson. The police also reviewed security footage from Patty Murphy's on the night of Jacob's death. The footage confirmed Marcus present at the bar, but there was a 2-hour gap where Marcus was unaccounted for. This window of time raised further suspicion, as it was enough time to him to commit the crime and return to the bar. Despite the mounting evidence and Marcus' suspicious behavior, there was still no direct proof linking him to Jacob's murder. The police continued to keep Marcus under close watch, hoping to uncover more information that could either confirm or clear their suspicions. On August 18, 2016, 6 days after Jacob's body was found, the Naples Police Department received a breakthrough. The day was hot and sunny, with temperatures soaring into the mid-90s. Detective Samuel Jenkins and Officer Karen Blake were in the police station when they received a call from a local pawn shop owner who had found something unusual while inventorying recently pawned items. He told the police that a gold bracelet described with the initials JAR had been pawned 2 days before Jacob's death. Jacob had posted a picture of this same bracelet on his social media, saying it was a gift from a client. The police immediately headed to the pawn shop, located on 5th Avenue South, a busy area filled with shops and restaurants. At the pawn shop, records showed that the bracelet had been pawned by Marcus Dane. This new evidence placed Marcus at the center of the investigation once again. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake were determined to dig deeper. The police brought Marcus back in for questioning. This time they confronted him with the evidence of the bracelet. Marcus's demeanor shifted from defensive to visibly nervous. He stumbled over his words as he tried to explain why he had the bracelet. Marcus claimed that Jacob had given him as a gift, but the police were skeptical given their contentious history. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake also reviewed security footage from the pawn shop. The footage clearly showed Marcus entering the shop and pawning the bracelet. The timestamp on the video matched the date on the transaction records, leaving little doubt about Marcus's actions. The police used this footage to challenge Marcus' story further. The police also re-examined the security footage from Patty Murphy's bar on the night of Jacob's death. They discovered that Marcus had left the bar for 2 hours, providing him with enough time to commit the crime. This new evidence painted a clear picture of Marcus' possible involvement in Jacob's murder. With the bracelet, the threatening text messages, and the suspicious gap in Marcus's alibi, the police felt that they had enough to proceed. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake presented their findings to the district attorney, who agreed that the evidence was compelling. The police were now focused on gathering more information to strengthen their case against Marcus. They continued to interview witnesses and piece together the events leading up to Jacob's death, determined to bring justice for the young man whose life was tragically cut short. On August 22, 2016, the Naples Police Department made a breakthrough in Jacob's murder case. Detective Samuel Jenkins and Officer Karen Blake had gathered enough evidence to identify the murderer, Veronica Hayas. Veronica, a 59-year-old astrologist, was known for her extravagant lifestyle and powerful personality. Despite her public charm, she had a dark, obsessive side, especially in her relationships. The investigation revealed that Veronica's obsession with Jacob had grown dangerously intense. She was furious when she discovered that Jacob was seeing other older women for sex and receiving expensive gifts from them, including the Audi SUV from Brian Mitchell. Veronica's jealousy and anger boiled over on the night of August 1, 2016. On that night, Veronica confronted Jacob at his apartment about his new car. An argument erupted, and in a fit of rage, Veronica drowned Jacob in his own toilet. She forced his head into the water until he stopped struggling, leaving bruises on his arm and neck. To humiliate him further and make it look like he drowned himself, she stripped off his clothes, making the scene appear even more degrading. Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake pieced together the evidence through witness statements, security footage, and forensic evidence. Veronica's alibi, which claimed she was home reading Astrology Today and meditating, fell apart when phone records showed she was near Jacob's apartment at the time of the murder. Furthermore, forensic analysis of Veronica's clothing revealed traces of Jacob's blood, linking her directly to the crime scene. On the morning of August 22, the police moved to arrest Veronica. They arrived at her mansion, a grand estate adorned with astrological symbols and crystals. Veronica was taken by surprise, her confident demeanor cracking as she was handcuffed and led to the police car. She protested loudly, accusing the police of targeting her because of her wealth and status. The arrest sent shockwaves to the Naples community. Jacob's family, who had been devastated by his death, felt a mix of relief and sorrow. They were grateful that the murderer had been caught, but heartbroken over the senseless loss of their son. Veronica's friends and clients were equally shocked, struggling to reconcile the generous woman they knew with the brutal crime she had committed. Veronica Hayas was charged with second-degree murder. Her trial would reveal more about the dark side of her personality and the tragic obsession that led her to take Jacob's life. The arrest marked a crucial step in the quest for justice, but the journey was far from over. Veronica Hayas' trials for the murder of Jacob Rasmus began in October 2016. The courtroom was packed with journalists, community members, and activists. The case had drawn national attention, with many people intrigued by the bizarre astrology defense Veronica used. She claimed she was being discriminated against because she was a Virgo, a sign known for being meticulous and perfectionistic. The prosecution, led by District Attorney Martin, argued that Veronica's obsession with Jacob had driven her to a murder. A 45-year-old with the reputation for being tough on crime presented the evidence collected by Detective Jenkins and Officer Blake. He showed the jury the phone records placing Veronica near Jacob's apartment. The forensic evidence linking her to the scene and the bruises on Jacob's body indicating a struggle. Delgado painted a picture of a woman consumed by jealousy and rage who had meticulously planned and executed the murder. He called witnesses who testified about Veronica's possessive nature and her increasing anger towards Jacob's other relationships. Delgado's argument was clear. Veronica's jealousy had turned deadly. The defense attorney Nancy Price took a different approach. Price, a 50-year-old known for her unconventional tactics, focused on the so-called astrology defense. She argued that Veronica was being unfairly targeted because of a zodiac sign. Price brought in experts who testified about Virgo characteristics, emphasizing that Veronica's actions were influenced by astrological traits rather than a criminal mindset. Veronica herself took the stand, tearfully claiming that she was a victim of discrimination. She insisted she had no intention of killing Jacob and that the incident was a tragic accident. Her testimony was supported by groups like Workers United and Americans Against Birth Sign Discrimination, who protested outside the courthouse throughout the trial. They held signs demanding fair treatment for all astrological signs and decrying the injustice against Workers. Despite the prosecution's strong case, the jury was swayed by the defense argument. On November 15, 2016, Veronica was found guilty of manslaughter instead of murder. The judge sentenced her to 10 years in prison, a decision that shocked many who had expected a harsher punishment. Jacob's family was devastated by the verdict. They felt that justice had not been served and that Veronica's wealth and influence had played a role in her lightened sentence. Friends and supporters of Jacob were equally outraged, feeling that the trial had turned into a spectacle rather than a pursuit of justice. Veronica's supporters celebrated the verdict, viewing it as a victory against astrological discrimination. The trial and its outcome sparked widespread debate about the role of unconventional defenses in the legal system and the influence of public opinion on judicial decisions.